Hello everyone. Today I will continue talking about Markovnikov's rule. In the previous video, we talked about the addition of hydrogen halides to alkenes. Today I'll be talking about the other reactions that follow the Markovnikov's rule: the acetylized hydration, addition of halohydrine, also the oxymercuration-reduction of alkene, and lastly, the reactions that doesn't follow Markovnikov's rule, which is the hydroboration-oxidation or non-Markovnikov's hydration. Now, if we started by the addition of water, which is the acid-catalyzed hydration, this is the addition of water in presence of acid. So, because it follows the Markovnikov's rule, what we expect is the addition of the hydroxyl group to this carbon, which carries the least number of hydrogens. And here, I will add the hydrogen because this carbon is actually contains larger number of hydrogens. Now, if I looked at my product, it will be CH3, and here I will have CH attached to hydroxyl, and then here I will have this double bond would break, and I will form here CH3. So from propane, we were able to form 2 propanol. Now, moving to 2-methyl propene, it will follow the same rule, which is Markovnikov's rule. The addition of the hydroxyl will be at this carbon, and the addition of hydrogen will be at this carbon. Now, I have CH3C, and then here I have the other methyl group, and here I have the hydroxyl group addition after the breaking of the double bond, and then here I will have the CH3, and by that we form the 2-methyl-2-propanol. Now let's look at the mechanism of the acid-catalyzed hydration of propene. First, what happens is making a new bond between the electrophile, which carries the double bond, and the nucleophile, which will give the proton to my nucleophile. Now I have the propene, CH3CH, double bond CH2. It will react with hydronium ion. In here, I have the double bond would attack this hydrogen, and the bond here would break. This is a slow determining step, which is a reversible step, and I will form the secondary carbon cation intermediate. So I have here CH3, CH, and I have here positive, and here I have CH3. So you could see that we formed the secondary carbon cation. We add the hydrogen to this carbon to be able to form the secondary carbon cation. If we add the hydrogen to this one, we would have formed the primary carbon cation, which is least stable. This is why we formed the secondary carbon cation. And then here I will have water, because this hydronium ion lost its hydrogen. Now, moving to the second step of this mechanism, what happens is making a new bond between the nucleophile and the electrophile. Now, my nucleophile would be, in that case, would be the water that would attack the carbon cation that formed in the first step, which is the CH3, and here CH, and here I have CH3. So one of these 2 lone pair would attack my carbon. So in here, it will be a fast reversible step, and the oxygenium ion would form. You could see that it is similar to what we used to do in the alkyl halide addition. The last step is a different step, because now after the oxygenium ion, we need to remove away this proton, because you have here the positive charge, and you need to move a proton away to be able to form a stable product. So you took a proton away from your product. And this step would be a fast step. In that case, what will happen is actually one of these 2 lone pair would take a proton away, and here the bond would break. So I would have the hydroxyl group attached to my carbon. And we formed the the 2-propanol. And of course, we will have the hydronium ion. because this proton will just move to the hydronium ion. So similar to what happened in the previous video, in the addition of the hydrogen halide, a rearrangement can also happen in the acid catalyzed hydration. If we started by the 3-methyl-1-butene, what will happen first is a similar like the previous steps. We will make a new bond between the nucleophile and the electrophile. Then what will happen is an 1 and 2 shift. So let's start by drawing the 3-methyl-1-butene. And here I have hydrogen bond, and here I have the double bond. If I reacted with hydronium ion, this one would act as a nucleophile, where I have the double bond, and this would be my electrophile. So this would be my slow determining step, where this double bond would attack this hydrogen, and this bond would break, and I will have here a formation of a secondary carbon cation. I have here hydrogen and I have here positive charge. If you could see that if this hydrogen migrates from this position to that position, I can form a tertiary carbon cation instead of this secondary carbon cation. So what will happen is actually the 1 and 2 shift, which is similar to the in the rearrangement of the hydrogen halide addition to this compound. So you could see what will happen is actually a migration of this bond from this side to that side. So electrons would just move to that side. And I have here hydrogen, and in that case, I will lose the electrons on this side. So this will form the tertiary carbon cation. Then what will happen is same as the previous steps. We will need to make a new bond between the nucleophile and the electrophile. And in that case, water would act as the nucleophile. And my tertiary carbon cation would act as the electrophile. Now, one of these two lone pairs would attack this carbon because it carries a positive charge. And I would form the oxygenium ion. I have here the two lone pair, and here I have the hydrogen, and I here have the methyl group. So lastly, what will happen, we need to take a proton away from my oxygenium ion. So here I will write down again my oxygenium ion. This would react with a water molecule, where the water molecule would attack one of these protons, and this bond would break. So you could see that in here we form a 2-methyl-3-butanol. So you could see that we formed the 2-methyl-3-butanol instead of the formation of 3-methyl-2-butanol. Now let's look at this exercise. Draw a structure formula for the product of the acid-catalyzed hydration of 1-methyl-cyclohexene. I have here the double bond, and I have this one. This carbon is carrying a least, the least amount of least number of hydrogens, and that carbon carries the largest number of hydrogens. So I select the addition on that case, the breaking of the double bond and the addition of hydroxyl to happen in that side, and the addition of the hydrogen would happen to that side. So we would form in that case the 1-methyl-cyclohexanol. Now let's look at the second reaction that follows the Markovnikov's rule, the addition of halohydrin. We mean by the halohydrin HOCl or halobromine, which is HOBr. In that case, if I started with bromine, the addition of the chlorine atom happens to that carbon, and the addition of the hydroxyl hydroxyl group happens to that carbon. So by that, the hydroxyl will be added to the carbon, which carries least number of hydrogens, and the chlorine in that case will be added to the carbon, which carries the largest number of hydrogens. Now, if I looked at, if I started with 1-methylcyclopentene and I reacted with Br2 in presence of water and dimethyl sulfoxide in order to dissolve the 1-methylcyclopentene, the addition also would happen of the hydroxyl to that carbon because it carries least number of hydrogens, and this one will, the addition of the bromine would happen. But what will occur also, a racemic mixture. We mean by racemic mixture stereo configuration, where I will have here widget hydroxyl and I have here dashed Br, or I can have a dashed hydroxyl and widget Br. Let's look at the reason behind the formation of racemic mixture. Let's look at the mechanism of the halohydrin formation, and we will understand why this racemic mixture would occur. And here, if I started with any alkyl alkene, in that case, I have C double bond C, and I have here hydrogen, I have here hydrogen, I have here hydrogen, and I have here R group. In that case, when it reacts with Br, each one of those Br bromine atoms carries three lone pairs. In that case, this double bond would attack one of those bromine, and this bond would break. So I will have here C bond C, and I will have the bromine. In that case, can be added to any of these those carbons. And then here I have hydrogen, and I have here R, and I have here the two hydrogens. A resonating resonance would happen where this bromine, in that case, would just move to that side. Because it is moving over my structure, a tricyclic structure would occur where I will have this positive charge delocalized over the two carbons. So it's not like I'm going to add it to this one or that one. Now, the second step would be formation of a new bond between the nucleophile and the electrophile. And in that case, the water would act as a nucleophile that would attack one of those carbons. So, like we saw, we seen before, I have here the tricyclic structure where I have here a positive charge resonating over my structure. And in here, I have the hydrogen and have here the R. Have here the two hydrogens, and if I use water molecule in that case to act as a nucleophile, it would attack one of those carbons. So it would attack the carbon which carries least number of hydrogens, and this bond on that case would break. So I will have here C bond C, and in that case I have here the bromine attached to the two hydrogens, and then here I have the R in that case and the hydrogen, and here I have the water molecule. And because I have here the water molecule, what I expect is actually the attack of another water molecule to one of those protons, and I will take a proton away. So I have here this water molecule that comes, so this would be plus. This lone pair would attack that hydrogen, and this bond would break. So I will take a proton away, just in here. I will draw it here. So I have here C bond C, and I have here the Br with the three lone pairs. And here I will have the hydroxyl group because here the proton will be taken away. Now, if I looked at this structure, what happens is actually the attack of the water molecule to the other side of my structure. So if the bromine atom on that side, the attack of the hydroxyl will be in that side. So when the double bond breaks, I have the double bond. When it breaks, the bromine will be added from this side and the hydroxyl will be added from that side. This is why a racemic mixture occurs where I can have a wedged or dashed. So I can have a wedged R and dashed hydrogen, or I have hydrogen wedged and dashed R. So this is why I can have a racemic structure. Now, my third step would be making a new bond between the nucleophile, which in that case would be the water molecule. And it would attack from the other side of my double bond, and the bond would break from this side. And in here, I will have hydrogen and the R. And in here, I will have the oxygen attached to two hydrogens with a positive charge. Now, what will happen, we need to take a proton away, and in order to do that, we can use a water molecule, where one of these two lone pairs would attack this hydrogen, and the bond here would break. And I have here the hydroxyl and I have here the two hydrogens. Now we need to do the reduction in order to form the alcohol. So to be able to do that, we can use the sodium boron. So I can here add the sodium boron on that case, and what will happen is a reduction where metallic mercury would form, plus here I will add another hydrogen to that carbon, so it will be CH3. You have to remember, because we attacked the mercury acetate attack the two carbons, the C double bond C from one side and the hydroxyl attack from the other side, we can form a racemic structure as well, where I will have here either the R wedged and the hydrogen dashed, or the opposite, which have the R dashed and the hydrogen wedged. Now moving to the last reaction, which doesn't follow Markovnikov's rule. In that case, if I looked at the hexene, when I add boron and presence of hydrogen peroxide, what I expect is the addition of hydroxyl to that carbon, because it carries the least number of hydrogens. Instead, what I have is one hexanol, where the hydroxyl would be added to the carbon, which carries the largest number of hydrogens. Now let's look at the reason behind that. The reason behind that is the formation of the boron first when it adds to the alkene. When I add it to the alkene, I will have the boron which carries either two R's or three, in that case, or three hydrogens. It will form a resonating structure with the transition state would have a carbon cation character, which I have here the carbon with the carbon cation. Over the hydrogen, the carbon that carries least number of hydrogens. This is why the boron would be added to this side. Now, the second step would be actually the oxidation of this trialkyl boron by the alkyne hydrogen peroxide. So this is why the primary alcohol forms instead of the secondary alcohol. So first, let's form, in that case, we will form the hydrogen peroxide ion. So I use hydrogen peroxide. And in presence of any alkaline inside my solution, I would form the HOO negative, which is my peroxide ion. This peroxide ion, in that case, can attack. So what I expect is the attack of this hydrogen to the formed trialkyl boron that we formed in the previous step. So I have here a slightly positive charge. This is why this negative charge would attack from here. So you would form, in that case, the B attached to the two oxygens. And here I have hydrogen, the lone pairs. And here I have the three alkyls group. And now I have the boron with a negative charge. Now the negative charge on the boron, what will happen because of that is a 1 and 2 shift. So in here I will have the boron. Let's draw it again. And a shift would happen to this bond from this side to that side, and this bond would break. So I would have the hydroxyl removed away, plus the migration of the alkyl group from this side to that side. So I will have here double bond. Now, this reaction will not stop at this point, because I still have hydrogen peroxide in my solution. And what will happen is actually in a three steps, a migration of the three, in that case, what will happen actually first, the addition of the addition on this side, then the addition on that side. So I will have here the boron, where I will have here OR, and I have here OR with two lone pair, and I have here OR with the two lone pair. Now this is a trialkyl borate, and this trialkyl borate, it will react with aqueous alkyne in that case to give me the alcohol. So simply you can just write it RO by 3B, and it would react with 3 sodium hydroxide, because you have to remember you have here 3 alkyl groups, and you will form the 3ROH plus the sodium borate. Now let's look at this exercise. Draw a structure formula for the alcohol formed by the hydroboration-oxidation of each alkene. Simply during the exam, you don't need to process all of that. You need to only just to remember that the hydroboration, when it happens, it is an anti-Markovnikov reaction, which means for this one to react, what we'll have is actually the addition of the hydroxyl group to the carbon, which have largest number of hydrogens, not this one. So I have here the least, and here have here the other carbon, which carries the largest number of hydrogens. This is why I will simply add the hydroxyl to that side, not this side. And we'll add the hydrogen to that carbon. If I looked at this methyl cyclohexene, in that case, also because it's anti-Markovnikov, I would expect the hydroxyl to be added to that side and the hydrogen to be added to that side. So I can just simply draw it here. I have here CH3, with here I have the hydrogen, and in here I have the hydroxyl group. But you have to remember it's a racemic structure where this double bond can break, and the one side will have the CH3 from this side and the other side will have the hydroxyl, which means, I mean by racemic, two major products can occur. I have wedged CH3 and here dashed hydroxyl, or I have dashed methyl and wedged hydroxyl. By that, we came to the end of the video. Thank you and goodbye.